talk inclusive entrepreneurship. Foundervine is an organization which seeks to promote and create inclusive opportunities for underserved communities within the entrepreneurial space. And its founder and owner, as well as renowned businesswoman in the UK space, Izzy Obeng, is here joining us in the studio and will tell us more. Welcome, Izzy.
Thank you for having me.
No, thank you for coming in. Izzy, Foundervine, why start it? What in your past, in your own personal experience, led you to think, I need to do something?
So I always talk about growing up where I did, and I grew up in a part of London called Tottenham. And Tottenham, I would say, wasn't the most inspiring place at the time. It's a bit different now, but a lot of people I grew up with had so much potential, but often felt just sort of isolated from, from an economy changing around them, and didn't really have the same kind of opportunities to grow. And I knew at the time that I wanted to do something about it. I didn't know what. Studied politics at university, thought I was going to get into politics. And it was during my time at university that I realised there was so much more we could do in communities through business and providing financial inclusion and wealth building opportunities to people who have been historically underserved by the business sector. So I didn't know it was going to be Foundervine at the time, but providing opportunities for people to get into business then became quite a driving force throughout my career. And in 2018, Foundervine was kind of born out of that as well.
Focusing on startups, right? So it would have been easy for you to go into big business, but you decide to focus on startups. So what's the idea that people have an idea but don't know how to expand it, how to let it grow? So you come in with help and advice, do you?
Absolutely. So we recognise that the kind of technical skills and competence are only one side of the equation. And when you're dealing with communities that have historically been underserved, whether those are women, people from minority backgrounds, people who are neurodiverse, whatever it is, there are real kind of confidence challenges as well as competence. So how do you go to a networking event and meet the right people if you don't have the background or the social capital to do that? How do you feel confident presenting and, talking confidently about what you do? And so a lot of our work is about providing access to networks and training and advice and coaching, as well as accessing the funding that founders need to grow as well.
So Izzy, it's very clear that you're working with groups and communities from underserved areas within society. Can you please address how you promote diversity and social and economic equality through Foundervine?
Absolutely. So we recognised quite early on that supporting founders was only one side of it. And if we really wanted to make a change, we needed to be quite loud and annoying on a more systemic level. So a big part of our work is leveraging the power of industry to support founders. So we work with corporates like Lloyds Banking Group, Barclays, PayPal, WeWork, to leverage their employees, their resources, their time, their energy, because, they have all sorts of priorities, but a big one at the moment, and I think sort of post Black Lives Matter, post the conversation about the climate crisis, is organisations are realising that double bottom line and that opportunity to support the communities around them more effectively. So we work with industry, and we also work with government. So we have advocacy as our final pillar, speaking and being a voice for founders who often don't have that voice. And so we contribute to policy. We often host roundtables where we just speak to government about where they need to be leaning in a bit more, but also stepping back. That advocacy piece and that industry piece is a huge part of our work as well.
So Foundervine is based in London, right, in the UK. How do you connect and support young people or communities within developing countries?
Sure. So about 3 years ago, we realised that the work we were doing in the UK was important, but there were parts of the world that needed it way more, where the need was far greater. A lot of us have kind of backgrounds outside of the UK, sort of family backgrounds outside of the UK. And so Africa was always somewhere we would kind of look at and saw a real need to connect opportunities and insights and knowledge from the country we were in, and diaspora as well, having the opportunity to give back. And we've been in Ghana for 3 years now, and the work there is very different. So whereas in the UK we support entrepreneurs who are often, you know, have enough of a background to have that kind of basic competency and knowledge, and you're just supporting them in kind of accessing the more technical skills and expertise. In Ghana, the need is much earlier. So we work with younger people, we support in building kind of core digital skills and STEM skills so that they can go through the education system with the knowledge they need to build the economy of the future. There's a real challenge, basic challenge, in terms of access to learning, particularly for girls. So that's a big part of our work in Ghana at the moment, and we're now doing some work in Nigeria as well.
And when you are in, say, the partnership in Ghana, and you're dealing with people who have cultural differences from the UK, and maybe one of those cultural differences is, you mentioned education, that perhaps they expect less, less is demanded of them. It's part of your work then giving them a shove, giving them a target. You can reach for the stars.
Absolutely. I think when you are kind of dealing with young people who may not have had the same kind of access to people or the same kind of exposure, and who may have kind of like over time thought, you know, that's my lot, this is what I'm going to aspire to. Giving them the opportunity to be exposed to the kinds of people in our networks, and also do the kind of activity that we do. So a big part of our work at the moment is Ghana is getting young people into corporates and, working on projects where they have the opportunity to essentially kind of build out innovation. And one of my proudest moments has been we have a youth leadership program that we run, and in the graduation day we had these sort of 16-year-olds pitch new innovations, and a lot of them were kind of looking into how technology could be used to support development in their own communities. And you see the confidence, it's there. But when you're kind of dealing with a society that sometimes tells young people that they should be quiet, they shouldn't talk back, you know, like, this is your station, getting them to think innovatively, getting them to exercise critical thinking and realising they won't be reprimanded if they speak their mind in a respectful way, that can be quite something when you see that journey over time in terms of public speaking, in terms of confidence speaking to people who are senior. It's absolutely amazing.
I suppose your role in some ways is like being a parent. You've got to give your children the confidence to face life, but then you've got to let them fly. You've got to stand back. How difficult is it then to know when they're ready to fly? And also, I suppose, on that theme, do you get people who are over-reliant on you and think that you're going to do everything for them?
Yeah, so when should they know how to fly? I think my approach is just to give them a shove when they're not looking, you know? And I think so many of us, particularly those of us who are kind of perfectionists maybe, we think everything has to be kind of perfect and before we do anything. And I often say to founders that by the time you think you're ready, the whole world has moved on. So just do it. Just do it. It could be rubbish, you know, it might fail. But that is such a huge learning opportunity. And so I think it helps that I am, you know, I was 24 when I started Foundervine. I'm 29 now. I'm often not too far off, I like to say, but I think I am like seen a bit older, a bit of an auntie when I'm speaking. But in my head, I'm their age, you know, I'm relatable. And it just feels different coming from someone who is perhaps kind of closer in age to them. There are no airs and graces, no ego, and they just sort of see me as someone hopefully that they can be like, and it removes a lot of the kind of overthinking and imposter syndrome that often comes, particularly for the girls in our network. If I can do it, and I'm not particularly amazing at anything, I always think I don't know what my skills are. I kind of just like, I'm kind of just ready to say yes to anything. And that's the approach that founders need to have, or professionals need to have. Just say yes and panic later. And once people realise that they don't have to have 100%, particularly women, you know, you can have about 40% and figure out the rest later, then that's when the magic happens.
Izzy, it's very clear that you are a role model for these people that you're working with. They can relate to you. You know, as you said, that you have, for example, a similar background to these people. And you, if you can do it, then they can do it too. How important is it that there are diverse role models, that everyone working within the space trying to develop their entrepreneurial ideas, how important is it that they have role models they can relate to?
The importance of it just can't be understated. I think it's one thing someone telling you that you can be something, but it's another thing seeing it, and, you know, reducing the kind of psychological barriers to that role. I always think kind of starting when I started my career, there weren't an awful lot of people I saw, you know, women of colour, whatever, in the kinds of positions I wanted to go into that I can look at and be like, okay, here is a path towards doing that. And what I've seen over the last few years is a kind of proliferation of women who are just being a bit more comfortable speaking up. It's realising it's not enough just to keep your head down and do the work. But be as loud as that guy, you know? Just kind of blow your own trumpet. If you've done something, shout about it. Use social media. And I often talk to women about personal branding and how, as a leader, how important it is to establish what your voice is going to be. And, you know, what does it mean to be a thought leader? What does it mean to share your journey, realising that you're not just doing it for you, you're doing it for the hundreds of girls who are watching you and seeing what they could be as well. And when you realise it's not for yourself, you kind of just, like, get over it and just do it. I love seeing, you know, people being kind of more active and sharing their journey, you know, regardless of their background, and just realising that people do need to see that representation is so important for the generation coming up behind us.
So I would like to go back to education. And you mentioned before that the kind of training that the communities within London require are different from the ones in Ghana, for example, that maybe sometimes you need to train them on the more technical skills, right? What role in general do you think education plays in equipping young people with the skills that they need to succeed? And is conventional or mainstream education fulfilling these needs?
Mm-hmm. So I think that conventional education has a role to play, but it has to be delivered in partnership with the private sector. There needs to be a stronger kind of collaboration between industry and education if we're going to see the impacts that we want. So we often talk about the importance of practical education in our work. So it's one thing having the theory, and, you know, we work a lot in universities and students are reading a lot about entrepreneurship. I'm just like, no, get out of the classroom and get into the communities and ask people what their needs are, so you can kind of understand these things. You know, get out and work in groups, build your teamwork capabilities, build your leadership capabilities, learn how to conduct interviews, all of these things, and really bring it to life. So I think that combination of sort of more theoretical traditional learning and practical learning gives people an opportunity to kind of simulate work environments, to get an opportunity to build more holistic skills that they'll need in the workplace. COVID has also shown us the importance of blended learning as well. All of our delivery moved online during COVID, and in that time we realised that, oh, lots of people don't want to travel into central London. They don't. They're mums and they've got babies on their laps on the Zoom call, and, you know, they live in Manchester and they're relieved that they can finally take part in a programme like this. So what does it mean to offer sort of provision for people who don't have the same kind of accessibility when it comes to more traditional, impersonal classroom methods of learning? So I'm very excited by the opportunities we have now to offer more remote opportunities and more practical opportunities alongside the traditional learning that's out there at the moment.
It does seem a bit ironic that in some place like Ghana, people are crying out for education. They can't get it. They want it. They desire it. They want to grab it. And yet in countries like the UK, where there is a good education system, people have access to it and go, nah, it's not for me. So how do you deal with those two different approaches? Because at the end of the day, I would imagine you've got to say to a young entrepreneur, a young startup, life is for learning. You know, you've never know enough. Even if formal education's not the thing for you, life experiences have got to be lived and you've got to learn from them.
Mm. I completely agree. And I think it's, you know, I often think about millennials get quite a bad rap when it comes to learning and kind of taking the opportunities and maybe being seen as a bit lazy sometimes. And I think about how so much learning can often like alienate people, and how not everyone, like you said, wants to learn in a classroom. Not everyone wants to learn in the way that school taught us. And a lot of people have had quite negative experiences in the school system for whatever reason. What does it mean to design learning that kind of meets people where they are? What does it mean to take learning into communities? What does it mean to offer learning through WhatsApp? What does it mean to kind of like have people just do stuff rather than read about stuff? And reading can be quite boring sometimes. I don't like reading books. I have the attention span of a gnat. But if you give me like a good podcast, oh, I'm really here for it. So what does it mean to kind of like just rethink how we deliver learning? Just go beyond the curriculum and actually say like, what do people need? Let's offer it in a range of formats run by people who are a bit different. And maybe you might see kind of people absorb that learning differently and just be a bit kind of more open to it. I think everyone wants to learn. Everyone wants to, find a way to change something or to grow something or develop themselves. I think often they just don't really like to do it within the established structures of learning.
So on that theme, do you have something that stands out in your mind as your biggest success story where you think, wow, I've really made a difference there, or the people concerned have really made a difference?
I'd say our Startup 54 program. So Startup 54 is a 54-hour startup building program where we get people who have never met before in a room, and they meet for the first time, form a team, build a business model, and pitch to experts all in 54 hours. And we had the first one in 2018, and since then we've had about 11 or 12 cohorts. And just seeing the kind of alumni kind of now, and a lot of them just go back into their jobs. They don't carry on with the businesses they build on the program, but they go back into their jobs with, greater leadership skills, the ability to work effectively as a team, entrepreneurial behaviors and competencies, and they just become better. And you see that confidence boost. And there's one 16-year-old we had on our program in 2018 who was terrified to come, and everyone was kind of 18 plus, and she's 16, she comes in. By Sunday, she's pitching, she's taking business cards off our judges, she's talking about investment opportunities, and she goes back to school and does her A-levels. And that's the kind of journey we see with a lot of our alumni. They're not going to build, multi-million pound companies. And maybe that's the idea they have in their head. If I'm not going to be Mark Zuckerberg, then maybe I shouldn't give this a go. But then they come on our program and it's like, oh, lots of people look like me. And, there's like music playing that I like. And like, Izzy's hopefully really chilled out. And, I can do this. Of course I can do this. And that's really powerful for me. Mm.
And of course that turns them into better citizens, more able to contribute to the betterment of the community. Do you find, though, that your enthusiasm is not always matched by the big businesses you go to for support?
I talk about the pre Black Lives Matter period and the post. The last couple of years have been marked by like a real kind of sea change in companies with regard to race and conversations around kind of equity and diversity. And I'd say that before 2019, 2020, I could kind of talk until I go blue and people would still it'd just be a harder conversation to have. Mm-hmm. And the gender conversation had gone quite far, but when it came to talking about race equity, it was just kind of a different thing. But since Black Lives Matter and the kind of situation in the US and what happened in the UK, it is a whole new conversation. It's, what can we do? And not just what we can do, but what can we do long term? What can we do sustainably? What can we do over a number of years? And it's been really exciting to see that. What I don't want to happen is for organisations to be doing this kind of work because the optics look great at the moment and it aligns to kind of priorities that are not really about communities, but are instead about corporate objectives. And so we always try to make sure that our community are at the heart of conversations when we're speaking to potential partners. If we don't get on, if we don't fall in love, if it doesn't feel like a fit, then we can leave it there. But I've just found a kind of renewed energy and enthusiasm around the conversation that we didn't have before.
But you know what? I think it's, in the grander scheme of things, it's great to see that this systemic change is happening to really be conducive and inclusive of minorities. And speaking of minorities, you mentioned women, for example. Girls are underrepresented in established businesses and startups. Do you see a positive change? Do you really tangibly see this changing within this space?
I wish I could give you a positive answer. I'm an optimist, and so what I see is kind of, positive sounds around the conversation around gender equity and kind of access to support and funding for founders. I don't think the numbers reflect that. There are still far too few women founders in technology. They receive far too little capital. A report by Diversity VC in 2019 found that only one penny in every pound of venture capital spending in the UK went to an all-female founding team, and 10 pence went to a mixed-gender founding team, and it was 89 pence that went to an all-male founding team. 2020, the stats in Europe are like very, very similar. And since then, we've just seen that progression. And so is there kind of renewed energy around women in entrepreneurship? Yes. Are there kind of more founders doing things and realizing they can? Yes. Is the money backing that up? Not necessarily. So there's still a long way to go.
So I guess that partially answers my next question, which is that, you know, the topics of diversity, inclusion, and inclusivity are on everyone's lips at the moment. But do you think this talk really reflects the reality? So,
it does. I have to be an optimist to stay in work. You know, so my job is to be optimistic about this stuff, and so I do think that there are kind of the signs indicate that. People are more open to, women are more open to going for promotion. They're more open to board roles and kind of having a seat at the table. Same thing when it comes to, people from minority backgrounds, etc. But what we really, really need to see from industry is like strong executive commitment to it and like putting financial targets against that, putting performance targets for directors against that, putting funding against that, and industry standards around it, holding each other accountable for what's happening, government having a more active role in setting the standards. And that's where we're going to see the real change. I love seeing some of the partners we work with and the moves they're making internally. Lloyds Banking Group has an amazing race action plan over a number of years to correct pay disparities, the support they provide to communities, investments and access to debt funding, all of those things. Love to see it. We need to see that level of energy across all of industry.
Well, we love to see your level of energy, Izzy, and we really hope that you maintain this optimism to continue driving this systemic change that is really needed. And to everyone out there, if you have an idea, just go out and do it, because as Izzy said, if you do it in 2 years, you might be left behind. So start now, start today. Thank you very much for watching.